When a song shark writes your music, but your words still sound like a hymn. When you're learning to play the guitar, and you've mastered it up in. Then it's time, when it's time, when it's time, we talk music.
Hi, this is Gary Forney. I'm a singer-songwriter. Today, this is episode 3. We're going to talk about these things. These mysterious objects. Records. We're going to visit 2 recording studios right here in Waterloo. Should be interesting, so it's time to Let's Talk Music. Hi, in this episode of Let's Talk Music, we're actually going to go to a few of the recording studios around Waterloo here. They're not the only 2 studios, but they're the 2 major ones that I happen to know about. If you have a small studio or something I left out, I'm sorry. Contact me, maybe we can do another episode with you. I'd like to give a big thank you to Tom at Catamount for agreeing to be interviewed by Hand Puppet. That was real nice of you, Tom. Thanks a lot. On a sad note, I'd like to send my prayers out to Jeff Isaacs and his family of Grand Junction Recording. Jeff has been my producer ever since 2001. Jeff suffered a stroke in December of 2006. Let's all hope for his recovery. Let's all send him our prayers his way. Today's subject is records, those round pieces of vinyl. I graduated from East High in Waterloo in 72, but I wasn't born in Waterloo. I was born in Owine, Iowa. You go straight east to Independence, and then you go north to about 15 miles, and you're in the small town I was born in, Owine. I first fell in love with music listening to my late father's old 78 RPM records, if anybody remembers those. Dad played a lot of the old country blues and a few things, and I fell in love with music, listening to those old 78 RPM records. I think that inspired my love for music. That's probably why I have a love for music to this day, and it probably shaped who I became. Those old scratchy old 78 RPM records. I had my first band when I was still living in Owine. I was in high school, and don't bother trying to find this band because we didn't amount to anything. But we did get a 45 RPM little deal. It fell through, but we were supposed to record a 45 RPM single. And it never quite happened, but teenage bands, they still dream of record deals to this day. And out of that fondness of records and recording, that's the subject for today. Now, believe it or not, people still make records, actual vinyl, physical records. I even have released 45 recently. Everything's not CD, but anyway, that's enough about me and records for a minute. Let's talk about recording in general. There are places that every musician's going to end up, and the recording studio is one of the main ones. Now, you can record yourself at home, and that is great. Eventually, that's a starting step. I have a friend who that's all he does is he records at home. And that is fine, but eventually what you will need is you'll take another step and you'll need to record professionally, which means the basic reason to record professionally is a producer. A producer is the guy who knows your music and what the potential is even better than you do. And so you're going to need a producer eventually. So anyway, we're just going to go out. We're going to visit a couple of recording studios in this episode. Catamount and Grand Junction. Anyway, I hope you learned something. Thank you.
puppy theater. Hooray, hooray, yay!
Hey, puppy, what's that?
It's a record. Records are sort of like CDs, music that was recorded on them. I think they may have been made out of a buffalo somehow. You put them in a merry-go-round-like machine that turns them, and they make noise. It sounded like music only with a hissing sound. This record is Jingle Bells, sang by the Chipmunks.
Wow, what are you going to do with it?
I'm going to play it backward.
Backwards?
I heard if you play records backwards that you can hear strange things, even make things appear in a dark room.
How very madam, I madam. Well, I'll see you later, puppy.
Bye.
Bye.
What's happening? Wow, it's Santa!
Puppy, did you play Jingle Bells backwards? Now I have appeared to take back all your presents.
Oh no, Santa, don't take back my presents!
Well, puppy, you did play Jingle Bells backward. But I'm just kidding. I wouldn't take back your presents, really. Play Jingle Bells the right way and let's dance.
Hi, this is Puppy. Wow, today I get to visit a real recording studio. This is Catamount Studio in Waterloo, Iowa. Let's go in. Why, look at the pretty red flowers and the desk. Wow, look at all the instruments. See the guitars and microphones. Amplifiers, wow, look at all them. There's some microphones for the singers. Wow, what a big studio. Over here is some drums. Look at all those big drums, big ones and little ones. Wow, a gold record, a real gold record. Look, someone's here. Hi, I'm Puppy. Who are you?
I'm Tom Tapman, and we're at Catamount Recording in Cedar Falls, Iowa.
This is a recording studio?
Yeah, we're a recording studio, and I'm the in-house producer, engineer, mixer.
Has anyone famous, like the Chipmunks, ever recorded here?
A few people, most notably a band called Stone Sour, that album sold over 500,000 copies, is approaching a million.
Someone made a gold record?
A gold record, yes.
Yeah.
Could I record here?
Well, we let anybody in, but it's a thing where, having been in the business for 27 years now, that I am able to be somewhat selective, and that's a good thing for everybody. If someone calls and wants to do a project, as opposed to just saying, come on in and on such and such a date and we'll record, it's like, let's get together and have a meeting and we'll see if I'm a good fit for you and can produce the type of album that you hope to have to achieve your musical vision.
What is a producer?
A producer is kind of the guide for the whole thing. I like to say that the artist has the what, in other words, what we're going for, and it's my job to understand that, and I have the how, I have the way to actually achieve the sound and the musical vision that that they have for their music.
Have you ever heard about playing records backwards?
Asking the practice back in the vinyl days of when people would record things backwards and put them in a record that you really couldn't understand. It sounded like gibberish, or you wouldn't really even hear it at all unless you physically turned the turntable backwards. Then you may hear a message. This was especially came to light to the public in the Sgt. Pepper and Magical Mystery Tour days, when apparently there was a lot of that thing that people suspect John Lennon put it in, trying to give Paul McCartney a bad time. There were things, I think one backward masking thing said, "I buried Paul," or something like that. Do you, that's what I recall anyway.
Okay. Did you know I played Jingle Bells by the Chipmunks backwards?
Didn't know that. I think I've heard that before, now that you mentioned it.
Well, I did. I hope Santa doesn't really take away my presents.
Not true.
I like to play dead sometimes, do you? Has anything bad ever happened here?
I think one of the worst things was an album I was producing for a blues artist from Des Moines. And in all of her rehearsals, their guitar player brought in a appropriate blues amp, some sort of small Fender or something like that. He was from Sioux City, and so when he showed up for the actual session, he hauled in this gigantic set of double Marshall stacks that weren't even two different cabinets. They were all, in other words, it was like as tall as him, and he had apparently fished it out of a dump, and it had been custom built for Tommy Bolin. He's from Sioux City, where Tommy is from, and so he had fished it out of a dump and refurbished them, and now he was going to use this totally inappropriate amp on a blues session. As we started to do the session, it became very apparent that he was not playing well. And ironically enough, in hauling these giant amps in, he had thrown his back out and was in excruciating pain and had to be replaced on the spot because he had decided that fishing a giant marsh out of a dump was a good idea and then using it on a blues session.
I like to sing. Listen. Arr, 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 arr. Tell me about singers.
Usually the people that we record, especially nowadays, everybody's recorded quite a bit in their home studios and that kind of thing, so I don't see a lot of that. You know, once in a while in the past, there would be people who just couldn't get it together. The most typical thing I see is when recording some kind of really aggressive rock band, like a metal band or something like that, when we're recording the rhythm sections, have the singer sing along as a guide track, so the band knows where they're at without even really thinking about it. And oftentimes you get done with a scratch track and it's time to do the real vocal, and suddenly this vocalist doesn't sound nearly as good as he did before. And a lot of that is usually because he's now standing in front of this gargantuan studio vocal microphone. He can't put his hands on a mic stand anymore. And so instead of using an $8,000 studio mic, the only way I can get a performance out of him is to set him up with a standard $90 performance SM58. And not only does he sing better, but he sounds better too, just because of being comfortable. But that's a fairly common occurrence, especially with metal singers. If we do live vocals and plan to keep that track, and I do sometimes, because sometimes the overdub, the real vocal, can't top or even get as good as deal with the technical part of it, of just technically trying to deal with fixing the scratch vocal as much as I can and making that work, as opposed to using an overdub that doesn't have as much feeling. So usually scratch vocals for that purpose are sung in one of our ISO booths, and those are full glass from top to bottom, so it really is almost like being in the room. Aside from that, I have a recording technique that sort of known for and which is attractive to a lot of musicians, in that even with loud rock bands, I actually record everybody in the same room with their amps right beside them, just like they play live, and often with no headphones. I'll often use monitors just like they use live. I believe that headphones are the devil's spawn, and should be used as little as possible in a recording session.
I don't have a band. Can you find one for me?
Most of what I do day in, day out is produce engineer mix albums for existing bands. But there's a certain number every year where it's an artist that has no band, that maybe just plays piano and sings and writes songs, or acoustic guitar and sings, but they want to do an album with a band. And in that case, I will handpick what I feel is an ideal group of musicians to put together to play for their album. And these are usually pretty high-level people, in that having done this for 27 years and made about 300 albums, I've probably worked with 1,500 to 2,000 musicians. And if you take the two or three best people at any given instrument out of that talent pool, you can put together a really great band out of that.
Do you have a website?
www.catamountrecording.com is our website, and that would, phone number is 319-235-6517.
Did you know I just snuck in here?
Plays really good music and writes really good music, and that's the best day I can possibly have, is recording good people playing good music. If you do that, come on down.
Thanks, Tom. You're very nice. Would you like to learn the secret puppy handshake?
Matter of fact, most of the people that have secret handshakes and try them out on me, I'm just like totally flummoxed.
Most studios, very few studios, they actually record vinyl records anymore. Vinyl has become a novelty item. I've recently done a limited edition 200 copy 45 RPM release of a record, but recording studios now, they're all recording CDs. I want you to know that I'm just talking about records because I love the old records. Recording studios, even though they use the word record, you know, like recording in their name, they're not making records. They're making CDs. Everything is digital anymore, and they're making CDs. But I still love the old records, so we're kind of joking around, talking about records here. The following bit is going to be a recording session I did at Grand Junction Studios in Waterloo with Jeff Isaacs. I couldn't do an interview with Jeff due to his stroke, but I wanted to include him in this program. And this will give you a taste of an honest-to-God, an actual recording session.
Well, actually, Gary, I think I'm ready to try one.
Well, I think we're ready too, aren't we, Josh?
Yes. Yeah.
One?
Now, the reverb that you're hearing is not going to the computer.
Okay,
that's right. Just in your headphones,
yeah.
Because we will assign whatever reverb sounds best when we do the final mix.
I do sound about 10 foot tall.
There you go, yeah. All right, well, I'll tell you what. You are rolling. Try one.
Well, I ain't got a bed, I just sleep on the floor. Used to get some loving, but I don't no more. All I get's a whole lot of hard luck going around. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down. Can't make a living, it's a waste of time. I'm just trading my hours for a handful of dimes. And a whole lot of hard luck going around. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down. Come this winter, gonna catch my death. Can't find a whiskey for to warm my breath. Just a whole lot of hard luck going round. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down, going down. Can you tell me what I'm doing, where I'm going wrong? All I got, a suitcase and a song. And a whole lot of hard luck going around. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down. There's someone on the corner, they're wanting 20 bucks. But all I got's a 10, a 5, and a couple of ones. And a whole lot of hard luck going around. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down. And when I'm dead, and when I'm gone, you can tell them I died of a whole lot of hard luck going round. Just a whole lot of hard luck going down, going down. Hard luck going down.
How's that? Go on, try another take, Josh, or you think that one's good enough? Let's try one more take. Let's try another take.
Sure. I don't know which one I like better.
I like the first one, I think, better. Which one do you like, Josh?
The first one's better.
Let's hear the first one next. I like the first one. I thought the guitar was muddy on the second one.
Yeah.
Although I like the ending on the second one. So you're the voice of Puppy.
I'm always a puppy.
What's it like playing a puppy dog?
It's a dog's life.
Do you enjoy playing puppy?
Yes, I enjoy playing puppy.
Voice for puppy. Okay. You know, I it's hilarious to puppy theater.
It's a lot of fun.
A lot of fun.
Are you recording this?
Yeah. Yeah, it's, you know, just a little, it's an interview with Puppy.
Yes, it's an interview with Puppy.
How are you doing, Puppy? You're the voice of Puppy.
Yes, I'm the voice of Puppy, and it's time to go visit Santa Claus.
Santa Claus appears in every episode of Puppy.
So far,
Puppy,
yes.
Puppy Theater, so far, Santa Claus appeared in every episode. But you're the voice of Puppy.
Yes, I'm the voice of Puppy. I gotta visit Santa now.
Yeah. Hopefully he won't take away your presents.
Nope, he won't.
When a song shark writes your music, but your words still sound like a hit. When you're learning to play the guitar, and you've mastered it a bit, then it's time.